I did open them. I opened them as much as I could. Oh yeah. I don't think terribly much gets down. You're heading off this week, aren't you? You're heading in. Oh, I thought it was this week. Yeah, I thought you were getting going up north.
Yeah, in July.
Oh, in July.
Yes.
Hey, 5 minutes. Yeah. Oh, I see. Got some time. This morning, I had my.
Wow. Happy Pride, everyone. Oh, we can do better. Happy Pride, everyone. Yes. So welcome to the service, of course, celebrating Pride. And just turn to your bulletins. And I'm going to ask Felix. Felix, do you want to come down to the front, please? I'm so excited about this, Felix. This is going to be the first time you've lit the Christ candle, right? So, thank you. Let's hear it for Felix. Thank you, Felix. And together, never forget, Christ said, "You are the light of the universe. We will shine so brightly that all will see and give thanks to God for it." The light of Christ, the light of our world. Thanks be to God. Just a couple of announcements. We're on summertime starting next week, and we are worshiping here at Trinity-St. Paul's. We are doing a whole series in July that I think you'll find really moving and enlightening. And that is, we are acknowledging our senior theologians from both Bloor Street United Church and here. So we will be featuring a different theologian every single week. So do come next Sunday, and it's also Communion Sunday. And today we're having coffee and treats in the garden. So thanks to James. So please join us for that as well. We have an acknowledgement of traditional territory.
As we assemble in this holy place, we recognize that for thousands of years, this territory has been a sacred gathering place for many people of Turtle Island. We respectfully acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of several Indigenous nations and wish to pay special recognition to the Mississaugas of the Credit. The original nations continue to cry out for justice. As treaty people, we commit to listen, learn, and work to right the wrongs of the past and present.
We can just follow along with our call to worship. And God said, "Here's the sign of my promise I make between myself and you and every living creature for all generations. I set my rainbow in the heavens, and it shall be a sign of the relationship between me and the earth. When I gather clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears, I will recall the love between myself and you and every living creature of every kind. Thanks be to God." And now, because we do not walk the spiritual path alone, but we do it in community, we are going to share the peace of Christ. And I started by saying, the peace of Christ be with you. Go for it. And children, if you want to come up to the front of the church, I think someone is going to share a story with you.
Good morning, everyone.
Sure, if you would like to. I am here to read a book to everyone, and the book is called Granddad's Pride. That is the name of the book that I'm going to read today. I'm just going to move my chair a little bit over here. Together we build a private Every summer, I stay at my granddad's house here by the sea. There are lots of fun things to do, like feeding granddad's chickens or going to the beach in his camper van. Now, what sound does a chicken make? Bawk, 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 bawk. Can we do a bawk, 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 bawk? Oh, that's a good chicken sounds. While Mom and Dad unpack, Gilbert and I go adventuring. Gilbert loves exploring, especially if it involves chickens. Now look at this, Gilbert is a puppy dog. Now what sound does a puppy dog make? Woof, 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 woof. Together we build a pirate fort in Granddad's attic in search for hidden treasure. What's this? It will make the perfect sail for our ship. Millie, dinner's ready, calls Granddad. Aha, I see you found my old pride flag. This is the Grandpa's pride flag here. What's pride, I ask? Pride is like a giant party where we celebrate the wonderful diversity of our communities and demand that everyone should be treated with equality and respect, no matter who they love or whatever gender they are. When your gramps and I were younger, we went to a lot of pride parades, said Grandpa. We marched and danced and sang and made lots of new friends all along the way. Can we go to pride? Could we go in your old camper van? Oh, my partying days are over. I'm far too old, and the big city is far too busy. Granddad is older, but surely he has plenty of partying in him yet. Why don't we celebrate Pride here instead in the village, I ask. Granddad needs some persuading, but the next morning we suggest my idea in the village. And soon it's decided. And here's all the villagers who want to support a big pride parade. We are going to have our first ever village pride. We put up posters asking for volunteers, and before long, the village is bustling with activity. My wife and I will make some flower arrangements, said Mrs. Alves. I can offer some rainbow carrots, says Mr. Singh. I can help Mrs. Lachlan and her daughter Fleur make a pride-themed book display at the library. Over the next few days, beautiful banners are made, flags are flown, and songs are sung. Some of Granddad's neighbors are even going to put on a drag show. I join Fleur and her best friend Io to make costumes for the parade. I feel shy at first, but I remember what Granddad said about making new friends. Soon we're roaring with laughter and glitter is everywhere. Everywhere. Io's sibling Temmie works in the bakery where we help them bake some tasty treats. Each color of the pride flag has a special meaning, and they are included in this cake, Temmie explains. As they tell us about the history of pride, I feel proud to be playing my part. Just like our cake, it's who you are inside that matters. Pride is about sharing all your beautiful colors with the world. There's only one thing left to do before the big day. Plan the route that our parade will take. That night, I can barely sleep. I am so excited. But when Granddad comes to say goodnight, he seems distracted. I wonder what he could be worrying about. On parade day, the village is filled with laughter, color, and light. But Granddad is nowhere to be seen. Oh no, does Granddad feel sad that Gramps isn't here to enjoy pride with him? What if he's decided not to come? Today won't be the same without him. We search everywhere. My excitement is fading away. Suddenly, I spot a familiar splash of pink. Granddad is leading the parade. He's at the front of the parade, and he says, "Thank you all for coming. Today, let's celebrate love, joy, hope, and families of all different kinds. Together, we can build a world where everyone is proud to be themselves." "You and Gramps are so similar," Granddad said. "He was always coming up with clever ideas, just like you. You would have so loved each other." I think I spot a tear in Granddad's eye. And then rain starts gushing down, but everyone keeps on dancing and marching and singing. Granddad looks out to a sea of smiles. A rainbow shimmers over the horizon. Perhaps Granddad is here with us after all. The end.
Special thank you to Drag Cheri. Just one announcement before we hear the scripture. A slight change in the program. Unfortunately, Pippa is not able to make it this morning, but instead, we are delighted, we are thrilled, in fact, to have our own James Holzbauer preaching for us. So thank you, James. And Willie.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Pride. I will be reading the scripture of Psalm 69, 7 to 10 and 15 to 18, and Matthew 10, 24, 39. It is for you, for your sake, that I have borne reproach, that shame has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my kindred, an alien to my mother's children. It is zeal for your house that has consumed me. The insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. When I humbled my soul with fasting, they insulted me for doing so. Do not let the flood sweep over me, or the deep swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me. Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me. Do not hide your face from your servant. I am in distress. Make haste to answer me. Draw near to me. Redeem me. Set me free because of my enemies. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house of Satan, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaimed from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Herein, thanks be to God.
Happy Pride. Over the 20-some years that I've been here as a part of this church, I've been asked to speak at Pride a couple of times. Generally, I'm given more than 15 minutes notice. So my remarks are impromptu. But as all of you know who have known me for a while, I don't have a problem filling empty air with the sound of my own voice. It's one of my favorite sounds, as a matter of fact. If you don't believe me, ask Wilfredo, who has to wake up every morning for 36 years and hear it, and go to sleep every night before it's done. About a decade ago, I was asked to speak here, and we had just come off World Pride. Toronto had been chosen as World Pride's place of celebration. And I was on an absolute high. I thought, this is fantastic, you know? I mean, Canada had just approved same-sex marriage and equal marriage, and everything was going swimmingly. Hillary Clinton was cruising to election as a neocon liberal. So that was thrilling. Had we known what was coming, we would have thought maybe more so. And I really thought that I was seeing the arc of history turn towards justice irreparably. And then what I call 11/9 happened. That was the 9th day of November, when Donald Trump assumed the presidency and became the most powerful man in the world. And I was, I think like all of us, gobsmacked. I couldn't believe what had happened. We were all sort of unhappy, one might say, about that result. But we had no idea that 7.5 years on, or 8 years on, we would be where we are now. We are in very, very, very unsafe waters at the moment. There is a worldwide fascist movement that is using religions to move forward. So you have Modi using Hindu fascism in India. You have Putin using the Russian Orthodox Church to promote fascism in Russia. You have the Christian right and the neo-fascist movement of white supremacists in the United States. You have Islamic fascism all over the Arabic world. We have authoritarian governments rising, and if you watch the news at all, you will know that their number one target is the LGBTQ community. I said a couple of weeks ago at this same podium that we can't go to a school board meeting, a town council meeting, even a library board meeting now, without hearing the catcalls of groomer and pedophile and child molester. We have seen this story before, and we're living it now. Make no mistake, we are in very, very perilous times. But today's Pride. So as mindful as we are of where we are, we also have to be mindful of where we have come from and who we sit with. You know, I have to tell you a little story about myself before I can relate all of this back to the incredible scriptures that Wilfredo read. And I have to say, I am amazed week after week after week how the lectionary somehow amazingly fits with exactly what we want to talk about on a weekly basis. It's almost divine in its ability to predict where we want to go. I was born to the last child of a fundamentalist preacher in the Midwest, and we did a lot of tent meetings and that sort of thing. So when I came along, I was the golden boy. I was the last of the eight. You know, I have four brothers who are fundamentalist preachers, and three brothers and four sisters who are fundamentalist preachers' wives. And I was destined to go to seminary and be a fundamentalist preacher. But as I got older, around 11, the folks in the farming community where we live said, there's something a little off about that preacher's last boy. And as I moved into puberty, it became obvious that I wasn't quite exactly what was anticipated or welcomed. And that tells you God has an enormous sense of humor. to send this along at the end of that trail of genetic material. It's okay, I'm over it, it's fine. And it was kind of a rough road. So I ended up leaving the church. I had a lot of self-loathing. I had a lot of internalized homophobia, and I hated myself for about a decade. And I considered ending my life on more occasions than I can ever possibly recall. I left the church. I became one of the new atheists. And I was living a life of some addictions and some bad habits. And then one day, George Bush invaded Iraq and called it a holy war. And something about that just made me so angry, because I knew Jesus. Yes, I knew the fundamentalist church, and I'd left it, and I knew all their faults and foibles and all of that, but I knew Jesus. And I knew he wasn't the Jesus that George Bush said he invaded an Islamic country for. And I had to hear somebody tell the truth about Jesus. I had to hear somebody tell the truth about Jesus. And I walked by this church, and I lived in the neighborhood, Willie and I lived in the neighborhood at the time, and I had seen, you know, the banners out front, and I thought, they seem like a reasonable bunch of Christians. And I came in, and shortly after Willie came, and we've been here for 25 years. That's how I got here. That's why I have hope, even in the midst of incredible despair. Because you exist. Because this place exists. This witness for the real historical truth of Jesus, the one that we hold to as the Christ, exists. And we have a purpose and we have a mission for the people like me who walk by and see a banner and decide that despite everything, love is real, God is here, Jesus lives with us, and we can have hope. So over the years that I've been here, I want to give a shout out to so many beautiful people, who many of whom have gone on, and I won't be able to name all of them. I think of Margaret McLean, who every Sunday when I was new and for the first 5 years couldn't get through a service without bawling my eyes out, would always be in front of me and always check in on me and always say hello to me and always make me feel welcome, and invited me to her home and had me for dinner and invited me to parties and made a mean Manhattan, of which she would serve exactly two and never more, which I thought was judicious in my case anyway. And Jim Kirkwood and Don Middleton and Clayton, and so many, many more, B.J. Thomas, and so many who are still with us, who have meant more to me than my own family. So this is a very special place, and this is a very special day. So what does all of that, my little, you know, story, have to do with the gospel and with the Bible? Absolutely everything. Because if we believe anything about theology and if we believe anything about the Bible, it is they are both God's relationship with us as human beings. That's what it is. That's what theology is. That's what the Bible is. It's the story of our interaction with the divine. Every time we messed up, Every time we failed, every time we fell short, you know, sin means missing the mark, falling short, not being perfect. Every time we do that, and then we have this fantastic example of our brother Jesus, and we have this story that tells us that the arc of history does bend towards justice, because guess what? We don't sell our daughters into slavery anymore, even though it's in our tradition. We don't have slaves anymore. We don't stone people for what they do on Saturday anymore, thank goodness. So that story of our walk, our journey with the divine is there, and it's here. And every time we open the door to somebody who doesn't have a home, every time we open the door to somebody who doesn't have a family, every time we open the door to somebody that doesn't have a place to sleep, or food on the table, or clothes on their back, or anybody to have them over for Christmas, we are continuing that divine revelation, that story of our interaction with God. I want to thank everybody here for being a part of that story, for being a part of this community, and may God bless us all.
Thank you, James. Just imagine what he could do with half an hour. So now it's up to you. You've heard what's been said. Did you want to say something, Elaine?
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the picture on the bulletin.
Go for it.
The artist is George Littlechild. The artist is George Littlechild. He's a native young man that was adopted by my Aunt Winnie Prince in Edmonton. He had been in several foster homes, and he was just such a handful, nobody could handle him. My Aunt Winnie Prince was a special woman. She took him, set him down at a table with crayons, and this is the artist that is here. And he is part of the LBG, I won't get all the letters right, community, but I am very pleased that someone in the Christian Reformed community stepped outside of the norm, and this is the result, and I want to honor her.
Thank you. Amen, Elaine, thank you. Anybody else want to say something? Yes, Amber.
I've been going from church to church. This is going to offend a lot of people, but it's also going to give us courage. We're all human, we all have hearts, and we all screw up, and sometimes it's really bad.
Amen. Amber, thank you for being here. Amber's first time. Amen. So now it is up to the rest of us to be generous, to keep this holy place going, to make sure that there's always a sanctuary and a safe place for everyone, that someone can walk in here for the first time or walk in here 25 years later and still be loved and still be welcomed just as they are. Yesterday, we had a phenomenal experience here, the first of its kind called Transformations. I want to acknowledge Jeffrey Dale in our midst from Shining Waters, who helped get us the funding for that. We're going to do it every year, and every year it will grow. And every year we will welcome those who are most at risk, trans, non-binary, gender non-conforming people who have very few places that are safe in their lives anymore. And yesterday, this was one of them. So when you donate to this place, you are donating to keeping people alive and children alive. That is what we do here. This holy church and sacred space stand firm in a world where many desperately seek acceptance, community, Christ. Trinity-St. Paul's has gifted us with a home and sanctuary where we thrive and flourish. Let us give generously as we are able to support this work. The offering will be received. Please be seated. We consecrate these offerings, spiritual and material, to the work of your gospel, O God. Use them as you will to strengthen and build your church. Holy God, we offer prayers of gratitude and gifts of resources, confident that your love working in this world can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine.
Sad eyes. Don't be discouraged, oh, I realize it's hard to take courage in a world full of people. You can lose sight of it, and the darkness inside you makes you feel so small. And I see your true color shining through. I see your true color.
Show me your smile then. Don't be unhappy, can't remember when I last saw you laughing. If this world makes you crazy and you're taking all you can bear, just call me up because you know I'll be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful like a rainbow.
Our prayers this morning will be punctuated by the words in your bulletin. One loving God, hear our prayer and in your love answer. Our sung response is also in your bulletin. Jesus, fill our hearts. Before we begin, just a word. I am someone who does not subscribe to the anthropomorphic vision of God as an old guy up in the sky. And therefore, prayer and prayer language for me, and I know many of you as well, can be a bit of a challenge. It's my desire that whether you are a traditional theist, a non-traditional theist, a non-theist, that you will find in this prayerful meditation something that resonates with you, something that challenges you to think, something that gives you courage to hope, and something that gives you strength to act. So I invite you now to prepare your mind and your body for a time of prayer and meditation. Please assume whatever position is your tradition or your preference. Maybe you prefer to kneel. Raise your hands, bow your head, close your eyes. Now plant your feet firmly on the earth from which you came. Strengthen your back. Take a deep breath and exhale. Focus on your breath. The breath of life, the breath of God, flowing in and out. And let us pray. We pray in hope for a world where sexual orientation and gender identity are not a defining factor in assessing a person's value. We pray for all of those who are suffering judgment, exclusion, and hatred. We pray for our own country and especially for our cousins south of the border. We pray that the current rise of white nationalism and anti-Christ religious fascism and its accompanying anti-trans and anti-queer hate be understood for what it is and the destruction it will assuredly bring. We pray that this hateful movement will wake us from our complacency and strike fear into the hearts of good people everywhere and inspire them to rise up and fight this terror before it is too late. Despite the nature of our current situation, we also pray for all of those who have not received the blessings of freedom and liberation that we here today have been graced. Our hearts ache, and we weep in fear and horror for the people that live in the 74 countries that rule over nearly 3 billion human souls, where sexual orientation and gender identity outside the heteronormative are illegal. Where your children, God, are punished by public beatings and incarceration, rape and mob violence, and state-sponsored murder. We pray in confession for neglecting to do all that we can do to end the oppression of others. We pray for the times that we have seen others' oppression as not being as important as our own. We raise our voices in song together. We pray in gratitude that queer, Black, and Brown people are once again leading the way, as they did at Stonewall, to challenge a homogeneous, corporatist, assimilationist, capitalist vision of liberation for the consumers and pride as a parade. We pray with deep gratitude for their courage to employ confrontational disruptive tactics. We pray divine blessing and protection on this generation of radicals and activists for justice. We pray in gratitude for progress made, freedoms earned, rights secured, hearts and minds changed, lives saved from disease and suicide, and lived with pride, as opposed to closeted in fear. We pray with thanks for HIV treatments, PrEP, hormone therapy, and puberty blockers. We pray with great thanksgiving that from all that has been revealed to us, the divine that we know honors and celebrates diversity. The very fabric of the universe and all creation join with the myths and the stories of faith traditions to teach us this most central divine truth, that diversity is a must for life, and it is our strength. This natural principle illuminates for us the necessity of celebrating human diversity in community. We have come to know that as we choose one another in kinship, we choose you, God, and we become your chosen people. Praise be to God for this divine revelation of kinship. We pray with gratitude for TSP and proud progressive Christians who seek to live a life based on the teaching and examples of Jesus, the Christ who died for the principles of justice and equal treatment for everyone in the human family. We pray for the Shining Waters Regional Council. We pray for Pioneer United Church, Parry Sound, Lansing United Church, Toronto, Virginia United Church, Georgina, Trinity United Church, Beaton. We are grateful for the United Church of Canada and other faith communities that embrace a theology of equality before God. We remember with gratitude those allies who chose to amplify our voices when we were too sick and too traumatized and too abandoned and bereft of the love of our kin to have a voice of our own. We pray for faith communities still struggling with full participation for everyone. We pray for spiritual wisdom and courage for the United Methodists, the Anglican Conference, the Southern Baptist Conference, and fundamentalist Christianity. We pray in hope for faith communities outside our religious tradition. We pray for increased spiritual wisdom regarding women and LGBTQ2+ people in conservative Islam, in Orthodox Judaism, and in all fundamentalist religious traditions. Please say with me now our prayer in your bulletin. Loving God, hear our prayer. And together we sing. We continue our prayers by remembering those amongst us who need our prayer. We pray for Linda Dawn Pettigrew on the passing of her dear sister, Heather Annie, after a long and serious illness. We pray for Susan Fullerton, Rodolfo Estrada Alcorta. We pray for Ashad and his visa application, Iris Horowitz, Karen Hilfman-Milson, Kim Thorne, Penny Regal, Tony Wise. We pray for Boutros and all the families in Sudan. Alana Hart O'Neill, Jackie McKinley undergoing treatment, Zayar M. Saeed, Jill Flewelling. We pray for J.R. and Amani Tarud, Mona Basbas, currently undergoing treatment for cancer. And we pray for those who loved and grieve Carter Benitez. And together we sing. With mindful prayer now, I invite you to remember a time when you were judged, when you were excluded and hated. Perhaps you were incarcerated in a residential school because of your ethnicity, or in an internment camp as a person of Japanese descent. Perhaps you were judged for being divorced or a single parent. Perhaps you were laughed at because you were physically different, or dismissed because you have a different way of thinking. Prayerfully recall who it was who first told you they loved you and that God loves you just as you are. Who invited you into belonging and loved you into the kingdom of God? Remember in your spirit how that felt. Feel the relief of being loved. Feel the release of that pain and burden of judgment. Release the fear and embrace again the tearful joy, the wonder, and the gratitude of belonging. Embrace again the love of living in community, in kinship. Feel in your body and in your spirit the freedom of love. As an act of prayer, I invite you now to look around this room so aptly called a sanctuary and see your kin, see your friends and your loved ones. See in a stranger's face your family and turn to them as an act of prayer and tell them, welcome to the kingdom of God. Welcome to the kingdom of God. Please join with me now in the ecumenical prayer found in your bulletin as we pray with the churches in Kenya and Tanzania. God of hope, whose spirit gives light and power to your people, empower us to witness to your name, to struggle for your own justice against all principalities and powers, and to persevere faith and humor in the tasks that you have given us to do. Grant that we may with one voice, one heart, glorify and sing praise to your name, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people say Amen.
We're the light of all the world. We are a city on a hill. We're a candle on a stand proclaiming light. We will not hide our lamp beneath a bushel anymore. We will shine a ray of hope that's burning bright. We are a rainbow, sign of covenant and peace, for the flood of tears will finally cease to be. Come shine your rainbow, splash your hues across the sky, paint the world in colors proud and bold and free.
So today I save the welcome for the benediction, because by now you should all feel so very welcome, no matter what you believe, no matter what you do not believe, no matter what you have done, no matter what you have left undone, no matter who you are, and of course, no matter who you love, because this is pride. And pride is every day. And know that when you walk in that kind of light, that you never ever walk alone, but that God, the source of all love, Jesus Christ, who is love incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, love's power, goes with you now and goes with you always. James, come on, up here, bro, come on. I mean, You know how much we love you and thank you so much.